Thank you for joining us today. We have a wonderful program. My name is Anna Campos, Acting Principal Librarian for Central Library, and I'm here to introduce today's program, Celebrate Frida Kahlo. Today is Frida's birthday. Happy birthday. Feliz cumpleaños, Frida. I want to thank the National Endowment for the Humanities for helping bring this program to you virtually. If you would like to see more of our amazing programs, please visit our online calendar at lapl.org/events, and we'll put it on the screen in a few minutes. Our website also has blog posts that highlights the library's diverse resources and upcoming programs. Now, for what we all have been waiting for, I'm very excited to have Dr. Gloria Arjona presenting today's program. Dr. Arjona is an educator, an independent researcher, a musician, an arts advocate who lectures on the rich her stories of Mexico and other Latin American countries. Dr. Arjona is a published author and translator and has produced 6 albums, including one devoted to the music that Frida Kahlo quoted in her art, and we're going to have the pleasure of listening to it at the end of the program. And now I want to welcome Dr. Gloria Arjona. Thank you for joining us today.
My pleasure. Thank you very much, Ms. Anna Campos, and thanks to the Los Angeles Public Library and to LA MAID program, and of course to the wonderful audience that is joining us tonight, today, wherever you are. I know I have friends from Colombia, from Mexico, so I hope you can get something from this program tonight. Why do we celebrate Frida Kahlo today? Well, because she was born on July 6, 1907. It's actually his 114th, she would be 114 years old. But she died when she was only 47, and she died also in a month like this month, in July 13, 1954. So why is it that Frida continues being attractive to so many people even after her death? She is a symbol for many causes for women. She is a symbol for people with physical limitations, for people with emotional problems, for the LGBTQ community. Frida symbolizes something to each one of us, even though we could question her feminism. No estamos seguros que fuera feminista en el sentido de la palabra. Why? Why I'm saying that? Because this obsession she had for her husband, Diego Rivera, and this frustration she had for not having children, for her many abortions, miscarriages, involuntarily miscarriages she had. So those issues would conflict with feminism today. But we have to see the person in their context. So within her context, within her social context, Frida broke many barriers. And now I want to share a PowerPoint, some images. Let me share my screen, and then, well, this is the title, Celebrate Frida Kahlo, and I already told you why do we have to celebrate her during July. I love this picture when Frida was a teenager or 19 years old approximately, because it shows us the rebellious person inside. Frida grew up in a middle-class family, which was very uncommon to the Mexico of the beginning of the Mexican Revolution, because that's another important period, important event to consider when we are addressing the life and the work of Frida Kahlo. She lived the revolution. Actually, she even would change the date of her birth, and she would say in some writings in her diary, she says that she was born on in 1910, the year of the Mexican Revolution. But no, she was born before, in 1907. But anyway, she lived the revolution, before the revolution, during the revolution, and after the revolution. So Frida, in many ways, is a daughter of the revolution. And we can see those ideas, those this attempts to emancipate since an early age. So right here, she grew up. Her father, as many of you know, was Jewish. They question, because she used to say that he was Jewish, but there are scholars that doubt about the Jewish heritage, but definitely he was Hungarian German. And he had come to Mexico. He was born Wilhelm Kahlo, and he came to Mexico and worked for the dictator Porfirio Díaz as a photographer. And he changed his name to Guillermo Kahlo. And he married for the first time, and his wife died. And then he married for the second time Frida's mother. Her mother was very Matilde Calderón. She was very Catholic. So Frida grew up in this environment. His father was liberal, yes, but her mother was very, very Catholic, very, very rigid, very in her moral. And you can see in this picture, where in this family picture, that Frida definitely contrasts with the femininity of her sisters and of her mother. So we can tell that from an early age, Frida was always wishing to break all barriers. Why can everybody identify, and why do we love Frida? I believe, and this is my personal point of view, I believe that even though her art has some complexity, because it has a lot of symbolism, we as a general audience can understand something. For instance, take this picture, the most famous picture, Las Dos Fridas, the two Fridas, and some people, people among the LGBT community, they can see that the love of two women. Other people can see the connection we women, the sisterhood, la hermandad, between women. And other people can see probably the duality we all have as human beings. I personally see something, a very important concept, and very important for this period, which is el mestizaje, miscegenation. Because we have on your right, on your left, I'm sorry, a Frida dressed in an European style, and on your right, you have the indigenous Frida. And that suggests el mestizaje, our European and indigenous heritage, not only of in Mexico, but of all speaking, Spanish-speaking countries of Latin America. Frida explained that in this painting, the two Fridas meant the Frida that was detached from Diego, the Frida on your left, because it was the Frida that was not very Mexican as Diego loved Frida. They say that Diego love the way Frida dressed in her Mexican attire and then with her braids. So we have two different Fridas before and after Diego. Why Frida? This is not a Frida painting. This is a painting by Maria Izquierdo, because there are some critics in Mexico that say, why this obsession with Frida Kahlo when there were other contemporary women artists who were even superior than Frida? And yes, one example is Maria Izquierdo. She was the first Mexican muralist, Mexican muralist, and she was the first woman, Mexican woman, or the first Mexican artist to have a solo exhibit in the United States. So if we compare Maria Izquierdo with Frida, Maria Izquierdo had more technique, more development in her themes. That's the same thing happens with Baro. Let me. I always change her name. This is Remedios Baro. Remedios Baro, who was a Spanish Mexican artist, contemporary of Frida, and as you can see, very complex in her themes. Okay, so. This sample of Remedios Varo implies a lot of research. And the same thing, another one that is frequently compared with Frida is Leonora Carrington. So why Frida? Why we tend to forget about these great artists, women artists, and concentrate in Frida? Well, as I said before, Frida is relatively, her art that has been classified as naive is relatively easy to understand. But I believe that there is also the personal aspect in Frida Kahlo. Frida is an open book, es un libro abierto. We know a little bit of Frida Kahlo, so we feel the connection with her. And her themes are so personal that makes them universal. Actually, this is the biggest art, the biggest painting that Frida had, because contrary to the other women artists that I just presented, Frida painted small paintings, basically, because she had physical limitations. That's probably one and the main reason. So this is actually the biggest painting she has. Now, this is a painting, a detail of a mural by Diego Rivera, the famous Diego Rivera. When Frida married him, he was the most important artist not only of Mexico, but of Latin America. So that was Diego Rivera. Now, I wanted to show you something. He painted right here the Spanish conquistador, Hernán Cortés, and behind him, his Indian interpreter and concubine, La Malinche, and you see the child, Martín Cortés, of Cortés and Marina, or La Malinche, which represents, this child represents that concept that I was telling you before, el mestizaje, miscegenation. So I want you to compare how did Frida represent el mestizaje and how the great muralist did. Of course, in complexity of technique and magnitude, there is no comparison, but Frida's art, in my opinion, is more subtle, es más sutil su aproximación al mestizaje. So I believe that makes her very unique in her approach to some themes. The same thing, this is the same Cortés and La Malinche, but this is by Orozco, another great muralist, and featuring the same thing, el mestizaje. Okay? Because it was a common theme after the revolution. the idea that you had to be proud of who you were. Okay, they were coming from a dictatorship. El Porfiriato is defined the dictatorship that disdained our indigenous part. So all these artists were trying to highlight and to glorify our indigenous past. Okay, so Frida, that's the same thing. And I believe, and it's not a very forced idea or an invention of mine, that right here she is alluding to mestizaje, because it's a theme that she repeated in several occasions. This is her family tree. And as you can see, Frida, as a child, there are two Fridas. She loved always the duplicity, the Frida in the womb of her mother, Matilde, and the Frida as a child, like as a 6 year old in La Casa Azul, in her famous blue house. And you can see that Frida is presenting herself as a result of her European father, who is on the side of the sea because he came from Europe, and her Mexican mother with a strong indigenous heritage. And you can see, and she comes from the land. So Frida, even though she could be considered white, blanca in Mexico, she was very proud of her mixed blood, de ser mestiza. Okay? Something, again, that was disdained during the dictatorship and before. Now, Frida, as many of you know, had a terrible accident when she was 19, 20 years old. It was the year of 1926. And what happened is that the trolley, she was coming with her boyfriend, Alejandro Gómez Arias, from a school in downtown Mexico to Coyoacán, which in those days was like a separate little town. Now is the same city. And they took the first bus, and then they decided to leave that bus and took another, a second one. And as Frida writes in her journal, that second bus is the one that destroyed her life, because that second bus was crashed by a trolley, un trolleybus, and was literally broken in two, the bus where Frida was traveling. And that's where she had her column, her backbone, broken in three big pieces, and then the right foot in 11 pieces, and then the handrail, as she explains in her journal, penetrated as a bullfight. A bullfighter penetrates a bull, okay, because it crossed her wound and her vagina. And that's where Frida later on would joke that that's where she lost her virginity, okay? So she had that kind of black humor. But anyway, she always thought that this accident, the bus accident, was had been the one that had ruined her life. But now new perspectives, new physicians believe that actually the problems she had all her life had to do more with the poliomyelitis, the polio she had when she was barely 5 or 6 years old, and that left her right foot in a pretty bad shape. And that later on, all the pain that she frequently had in the back, of course, it was related to the accident, but also it was like a return of the polio, okay? So it was also the disease that was attacking her body, and that eventually led her to be dependent on tranquilizers, on alcohol, marijuana, all kinds of remedies to diminish her pay. Okay, so these are actually the two paintings. Frida had, above everything, a great resilience, because it was after the bus accident that she had to be almost a year in bed when she started to paint seriously. And these two paintings are among her first paintings. You can see self-portrait in a velvet dress that doesn't have to do anything with her later self-portraits, okay? It's more like in the Italian Renaissance style that she painted herself, okay? And then the picture she did for her boyfriend, who was kind of forgetting her, is more like in a traditional portrait style. So she is still trying to find out her style. It was until she married Diego Rivera about 3 years after her accident, when she started to explore more with the Mexicanes, la mexicanidad. So this is Time Flies, El Tiempo Vuela, of 1929, a self-portrait of the same year when she married El Sapo, as she used to call him as de cariño, El Sapo. Just imagine if she called him like that, de cariño, what did she call him when she was mad, okay? So it was El Sapo, or La Rana, all kinds of names for Diego Rivera, who was more than 20 years older when he married Frida Kahlo. She was 21 and he was like a 42. But see the influence that Diego had in her art. But I still believe that she, and it's a fact, she found her own style. And I want to point out right here, because I am a literature person, okay? I always pay attention to the narratives, okay? So I want to highlight the symbolism here of that is instead of the writing, el tiempo, and we have the clock, vuela, and we have a flight. Time flies, okay? So it seems to me that this narrative part was always present in the work of Frida Kahlo and is an aspect that we have not explored. So whenever I say that I'm going to talk about Frida Kahlo, sometimes people say, oh, again, we know everything about Frida. And my question to you and to all the people, yeah, how much do we know about her actual work? Because she really had something to say in her paintings. If we don't know too much, it's because we don't explore. Her life is so fascinating that we do not go farther. Okay, so from this point on, I will concentrate, and I have to be careful about the time, I will concentrate in the narrative aspect of Frida. And that's what I want you to take tonight, the narrative in her visual work. There is a tradition. This is not a work of Frida. This is a popular art in Mexico, but it's actually, it's called retablos and exvotos. And this is a religious art, a religious form of an art that is religious, that actually came with the Spaniards at the beginning of the 16th century, not only to Mexico, but to the other places of the Spanish-speaking countries of Latin America. The retablos, the exvotos. I even saw in Netflix that there was a movie from Bolivia that is called retablo. Okay, so this concept and the idea with this religious art, popular art, is that when somebody goes through an accident, for example, or a period of tribulation, and that person succeeds, that person overcomes that accident, as it was the case of Frida, that she overcame her accident, people in the little towns mainly, they would order a retablo, an ex voto, to local artists and say, okay, hey, I want you to paint what happened to me. Like right here, we can say in this anonymous retablo, a couple that was probably assaulted in the road, okay? And the artist would paint what happened actually to the person that overcame that tragedy. And then they narrate what happened, and then they will have the saint or the virgin that helped them to overcome that accident. So as you can see, there are three parts, okay? The visual part that narrates what happened, the narrates in visual art, but then you have the narration that says usually, le doy gracias a la Virgen de los Remedios, I thank the Virgin of the Remedies because I went through this and she helped me. And then we have the Virgin or the saint that helped to overcome that tragedy. And Frida took, I have here, Frida took that and she developed that that kind of popular art, religious art, but of course she changed. She changed it a little bit as she played with the images, even with the religious images. Right here is what happened to Frida. And then she writes, los esposos Guillermo Calo and Matilde, okay, the husband and wife, Guillermo and Matilde Calo, give thanks to the Virgin of Dolores because her daughter, but actually it was not her father and mother who ordered this retablo, but it was Frida who did everything, okay? So right here, she has the three parts. And if you explore some of the work and mainly the work of the 30s, before 20s, 30s, you will see that she used a lot this form of retablo. So it's something very, very interesting that we can research on Frida Kahlo, this popular art that she recovers in her art, okay? And right here is the translation of what you can see here. Okay, and this is, again, this is not Frida because I want you to point out to the biggest influence, or among the biggest influence of Frida Kahlo was the great artist José Guadalupe Posada, that we know him because of the calaveras, the skeletons of the Day of the Dead. Okay, so that's the most popular, that's what you see it over there. But Posada, who was a great influence, not only in Frida, Frida did not need Posada because he died kind of early. Actually, the only ones, Diego Rivera met him, and then Orozco also met him. And I'm pointing out to that because José Guadalupe Posada had a lot of influence in Diego Rivera and in José Clemente Orozco, mainly. And in other artists, okay? José Guadalupe Posada is el artista del pueblo, the populace artist, okay? He would create all forms of popular art for the illiterate people that was the majority in the late 19th century, early 20th century Mexico. So what did Posada do? He would do these calaveras that we know, but not only the visual calaveras, but a narrative. But by the way, we have also this thing. I recently wrote a book on the literary calaveras of José Guadalupe Posada. Okay, so Frida takes from José Guadalupe Posada. Right here, if you see any work of Posada, if you see the actual work, you will see that he devoted as much importance to the visual as to the narrative. Okay, and it's something again that we tend to ignore. Okay, Frida took a lot from José Guadalupe Posada. There is an anecdote that she was in when she had already married Diego Rivera. She was in a hotel in New York, and there was a journalist that came to see her, and he was surprised to see on the wall of her room, the hotel's room, a lot of drawings, strange drawings and skeletons. And later on, Frida explained him that it was, they belonged to José Guadalupe Posada, because she said that she had them posted everywhere, otherwise she would die of boredom in New York. Okay, so right here we have, this is a painting of Frida Kahlo. This is one of the few paintings that is not a self-portrait. Most of the paintings of Frida Kahlo, as you know, are self-portraits. Out of almost 200 paintings that she did, about 50 are self-portraits. So one-third of her work are self-portraits. But right here is a painting that she did because a friend of this actress, Dorothy Hale, the mother of Dorothy Hale was friend of Frida's friend. And Dorothy Hale was an actress, kind of not very well known in the United States, an American actress, and she committed suicide. So this friend, this common friend of Frida and Dorothy's mother, wanted to honor Dorothy Hale, so she asked Frida for a painting. She was thinking more like in the retablos. She was thinking on honoring Dorothy Hale. But look what Frida did. She actually painted the suicide. I mean, of course, when her friend received this, she said, I'm not going to give this to Dorothy's mother. So she just paid for the work, and she was offended, and she put it away. I don't know now how much does it cost, because Frida is now the Latin American woman artist whose work has sold for more money of all Latin American women. So this is the suicide of Dorothy Hale of 1938. Why I am referring to this painting? Well, because there are scholars who have noticed the connection between a story that José Guadalupe Posada, remember that he painted and he drew for the populace, okay? So there is a story very similar, and there is a belief that Frida took the idea of doing this portrait of the suicide of Dorothy Hale based in a bulletin of José Guadalupe Posada, based in his drawing and in his noticia, in his news, okay? Again, I am with Posada, but I am leading to Frida, okay? I want to point out something. José Guadalupe Posada used music. He used corridos. He would illustrate, like for example, this corrido, La Valentina. He would go from drawing to music. Okay, so not only news, not only literary calaveras, but also popular music in his work. OK, okay? Because he wanted to get to the people. Remember, again, we are talking about the late 19th century, the early 20th century, when most people in Mexico were illiterate. And José Guadalupe Posada was an artist that worked for the people and to the people, okay? So he illustrated revolutionary ballads, corridos. He illustrated, and he used to go from narrative to drawing. And Frida does the same thing. This is an announcement. This is a research Ms. Campos mentioned that I made an album on Frida Kahlo, because I was amazed to find the same thing, that Frida is actually quoting popular songs, folk songs, in some of her self-portraits. And I tried to recover some of those, because now I have found more, and put them together in this album that is called Frida Kahlo, Tree of Hope. But this is a painting of 1940, and it's called Self-Portrait with Cropped Hair. And if you can see right here on the top, there is a pentagram. So the connection is obvious. Frida wanted the viewer to imagine or to hear those verses of the song. That's amazing. In a period of time now that we value interdisciplinarity, that we love to go from where breaking from rigid divisions of genres, Frida was doing the same thing, again, based in the work of José Guadalupe Posada. So this was actually what called my attention to concentrate, to do more research on Frida Kahlo, that she was quoting a song, and that some scholars have mentioned that Frida is quoting a song, but it seems to me that nobody was very interested in exploring that part, that musical part, because Frida in the real life, she was, in the portrait, she was suffering. It seems that the visual art was where Frida would live her pain. But in the real life, she was a very happy and dicharachera. She would say a lot of sayings, and a person that loved to sing. Los Fridos, those disciples of Frida, they say that La Maestra, referring to her, she would love to sing, and that she would sing very, very well, okay? Almost like a pro. So right here, there are these verses. Mira que si te quise fue por el pelo, ahora que estás pelona ya no te quiero. Look, if I love you, it was because of your hair. Now that you are bald, I don't love you anymore. And we must remember that everything that Frida painted had to do with her life. And many things in her life had to do with love. And most things about her love have to do with Diego Rivera. So right here, what happened, this is from 1940, is that Diego, they had an open marriage. Again, they were a product of the Mexican Revolution. So Frida could have the lovers she wanted, and Diego could have the lovers he wanted. And Frida went even further, because she had men and women lovers. But what happened? Diego had an affair with Frida's younger sister, Cristina, who was posing for a mural for Diego. So Frida was very, very offended for this, more to Diego, because she believed that Diego had seduced Cristina, because Diego was a colmilludo, as we say. He had a lot of experience seducing women. So Frida and Diego decided to separate, and later on, Diego asked her for divorce. It was not Frida, but it was him who asked her for divorce. But the best work of Frida is when they were separated. So right here, The first thing that she did in real life is to cut her hair and to stop using those braids that Diego loved, to stop being the Frida that Diego loved, and decided to wear, to dress differently. I found out that these verses belong to the popular song, the most popular Mexican song, which is Cielito Lindo, which is another story, another very interesting story, because Cielito Lindo, although the lyrics that we know are attributed to a Mexican composer, Quirino Mendoza, but actually Cielito Lindo is a song that came with the Spaniards in the early 16th century, came to Mexico and other places of Latin America. And in Mexico, we adapted and we changed it, okay? But if those of you who know the song, De la Sierra Morena, Cielito Lindo, Vienen Bajando, that Sierra Morena is not in Mexico, but is in Andalucía, España. Okay, but anyway, Frida was quoting that song. Mira que si te quise, fue por el pelo. Ahora que estás pelona, cielito lindo, ya no te quiero, ay, ay, ay. Okay, so those are part of Cielito Lindo and El Butaquito that we sing together. Right there you have, usually when I do this presentation live, that hopefully we can be together live, I get the guitar and we sing, okay? Because we love to sing and Frida loves music. Anyway, after finding out about those verses, I was very, very inspired. And then every single writing narrative, form of narrative that I found in the visual work of Frida Kahlo, I explore. So right here, we have another song. Yes, well, it's not another song. It's actually the same song, Árbol de la Esperanza, Mantente Firme. There is a story behind the painting. She was, this painting is from 1946. She had remarried Diego. They were separated and then they married again. And she had a surgery, one of the more than 30 surgeries that she had during her short life. And that surgery in a way was a failure. She had a lot of hope with that surgery. They were going to fuse her colon because it was unbearable for her to be sitting. It was not a matter of, like that they were going to let her ready to walk. No, it was just a matter that she wanted to be able to be sitting without so much pain. So they did that, as you can see in the two Fridas, the one immediately after the surgery, still with the big scars in her back, and the Frida sitting and with feeling relief of that corset that she hated so much, okay? But again, the surgery was not as effective as they thought, but still Frida had hope, as you can imply for the flag that says, Árbol de la Esperanza, Mantente Firme, Tree of Hope, Keep Firm. And this is a popular, many of the sayings that we think that Frida invented, she really did not invent them. She used, they belong to the folk, to the popular dominion, and she would use them, okay? And some of them, she would change them. So these verses belong as well to the song Cielito Lindo, Árbol de la esperanza, mantente firme. Que no lloren tus ojos, cielito lindo, al despedirme. So I wanted to show you how she uses verses of that song, okay? And then I want to show you the next painting and the next song. I want to leave some time for questions or comments you might have. I don't know if many of you know that Frida, before having that accident that left her in bed for almost a year, She wanted to be a physician, ironically, because she lived her life, the rest of her life, among physicians, okay, but as a patient. So she learned a lot of anatomy. That's why she is very good with the human form, okay? And she had a great admiration for Luther Burbank. We have a city in his honor, who is the father of hybridism. Okay, so she was fascinated by science. Okay, so she painted this hybrid person, half Luther Burbank and half a tree. And later on, exploring with the same ideas of hybridismo, she painted herself with the face of a deer. Her face, and then the body of a deer. El Venadito Herido is the name of this painting. And of course, El Venado, the horns, in Mexico, and I guess in many Latin American countries, the horns symbolize los cuernos, right? Symbolize when somebody cheats on you. When somebody cheats on you, your horns appear, okay? And Frida painted big horns because she knew that Diego Rivera was cheating big on her. But let's be honest, she also had a lot of affairs, okay? This painting, El Venadito Herido, she painted also in 1946. Actually, this is before the surgery of the previous Árbol de la Esperanza. This is after 1946, after the surgery, and this is before the surgery. And I point out to that because she was afraid of that big surgery because it was going to be a very big surgery and risky, okay? So she was afraid. And I believe that in painting herself as a little wounded deer, she is alluding to that scary moment and to that feeling of fragility, okay? And of course, also there are some tears, maybe it's not very clear, but there is also the physical and the emotional pain caused by this relationship of love and hate she had with Diego Rivera. I found out that This I didn't have to find out because I knew when I saw the title El Venadito Herido, there is a popular song, again, that belongs to the public domain with the same name, El Venadito Herido. And that's the song I'm going to play at the end of this presentation. Let me see if I have, I don't have anything else. Okay, so that's the song I'm going to play. And let me explain you a little bit of what you are going to see. And to hear, you are going to hear this song that is called El Venadito Herido, just like the title of Frida's painting. And you will see during the playing of the song, I am singing the song, and you will see some of the images that you saw here. I want you to pay attention in. She starts with a few sayings. Actually, I start with popular sayings she used to say, okay? And then you will see El Venadito Herido, and then Frida with crop hair. What I wanted to do in this video is to include the many references that Frida makes to music, okay? And then you will see something very interesting from the movie Frida of Salma Hayek, that she does a tableau vivant, a living picture of the self-portrait with crop hair. So I wanted to point out two important moments. And I'm going to conclude my presentation with that video that Anna will play for us. And then we'll open to questions or any commentaries that you may have.
I get drunk to drown my sorrow, but the bastards already learned to swim.
Soy un pobre venadito que habita en la serranía. Soy un pobre venadito que habita en la serranía. Como no soy tan mansito, no bajo agua de día, de noche, poco a poquito, y a tus brazos vida mía. Ya tengo listo el nopal donde de cortar la tuna. Ya tengo listo el nopal donde de cortar la tuna. Como soy hombre, no tener una, me gusta tener de dos, por si se me enoja alguna.
Hay pies pa' que los quiero, y tengo alas pa' volar.
Quisiera ser perla fina de tus lúcidos aretes. Quisiera ser perla fina de tus lúcidos aretes. Pa' besarte la orejita y muerte los cachetes, quien te manda a ser bonita, si esto a mí me compromete. Ya con esta me despido, pero pronto doy la vuelta. Ya con esta me despido, pero pronto doy la vuelta. Nada más que me libre Dios de una niña mosca muerta, de esas que hay más. Mamá, por Dios, pero salen a puerta.
Está muy lindo el video, doctora Arjona, me encantó.
Muchas gracias, gracias.
Creo que la audiencia, como yo, hemos aprendido muchísimo, muchas cosas que yo no sabía, y ahora quiero ir a leer más libros de Frida Kahlo. Y para la audiencia, tenemos los libros en la biblioteca, recuerden, con su tarjeta de biblioteca pueden prestar los libros, tenemos libros digitales, también ahora estamos abiertos, entonces pueden ir también a su biblioteca pública a sacar los libros. Y acá sí, usted dijo que vamos a contestar preguntas. Vamos a empezar con los comentarios.
Y pueden ser en inglés y o en español, ¿verdad, Ana? Por si acaso.
Yes.
So, yes. English or Spanish.
English or Spanish.
No other language, okay.
Hello, we can. So here we go. So good to see you. This is from Mari Nobre.
Mari Nobre, hi.
Happy birthday, Frida. We're celebrating Frida Kahlo. And I think I just realized I switched Spanish completely in the head. And I was like, I just realized, like, wait, this is English. So here we go. Oh, I think when we're talking about artists, Jana, María Izquierdo, Remedio Varo, Lenoro. So también hay otros artistas.
Yeah, Nahui Olin, yes, of course. Yeah, I just mentioned a few. Thank you very much, Jana. Shaduk Hernandez, for pointing out. So, but my point was that there were so many great women artists and models, because Olina was a model, okay? And still, it's like a Frida, in a way, her popularity has overcome the other artists.
Thank you. The comment, the eyebrows, I know that's what everyone, she's very known for, her eyebrows.
Yes. Yeah, and it's something interesting, because now that they mentioned the eyebrows, because she highlighted characteristics that are not very feminine. So in a way, even it looks like a cliche, and might seem like a cliche, but she invented her own beauty. Because, I mean, nobody back in her times, and not even today, would exaggerate the facial hair, and she did it, and it still ended up being very, very attractive. Okay, so it's like she forced us to accept her beauty.
Yep. There's another comment.
Thank you, Alba.
Thank you. Then, of course, Rick Salazar, the stories, they were great stories. Very fascinating. Okay, I think we know there's we know that Frida influenced Chavela. Was there any songs that Chavela either wrote or performed that is directly connected to Frida or her work?
Yeah, well, yes, in this movie, Frida, Chavela Vargas plays Chavela Vargas and Lila Downs also. They play music, and something that we can relate Chavela with Frida Kahlo are two popular sones that are La Bruja and La Llorona. So those are songs not composed. Chavela Vargas, as far as, well, she composed a few songs, yes. But there are critics that still question, and I'm not going to delve into that, but some critics still question if Chavela really was a lover of Frida Kahlo, because we know that because Chavela says that, okay? And there is a picture, only one photograph and one letter that might connect Chavela Vargas with Frida Kahlo, but let's suppose that they met each other and they were in a way lovers, they had some affection. Yes, definitely these two songs, traditional songs from Oaxaca, La Llorona and La Bruja, definitely are connected with Chavela Vargas and the role she played in the movie of Frida Kahlo.
Okay, we have, there's a question from Mariposa Azul. What was her last art piece?
Ah, Viva la Vida. It was not a self-portrait, but it was, I'm sure that Mariposa Azul knows these sandías, okay, una naturaleza muerta, okay, and she says, Viva la Vida. She did this painting because somebody asked her to do it for her, but the words Viva la Vida are like a carved in the watermelon. And it's interesting that she finished that painting 1 week before she died.
Okay.
Yeah. We don't know if she died. She died of an overdose. What we are not sure if it was an accidental overdose or if it was really a suicide, because she attempted to commit suicide, but still she is praising life. But the life she was living by then was very miserable because she was in constant pain. So it was not a life anymore. And she, her mood, her character, everything, her happiness had gone. So she was not the person she used to be anymore. So she preferred to end with her life. Viva la vida.
Here we got, it's a great presentation.
Thank you.
Another, Jana, it was a great point, so important. Y en español, muchas gracias por la presentación. Aprendí muchas cosas el día de
Qué
hoy.
Bueno.
Yo también.
Qué bueno, Blanca.
Lizzie, I really enjoy learning more about Frida. What is your favorite painting of hers?
Ay, I like the paintings that have music. So probably Frida Kahlo with cropped hair, but you know what? I believe that what the relationship we have with the artist, it depends on our mood. It depends on how we are during a period of time that we prefer this or that artwork. Right now, because I am focused on the relationship of music with painting, I like Frida con pelo corto, Frida with cropped hair.
Okay, and then there's another question from Angela. Ellos
yes.
fueron pareja abierta, pero sufrieron por ello. So
yeah.
Were they open marriage, and did they suffer for that?
Yeah, exactly. They suffer, they hurt each other a lot, okay? Sometimes when I present, people tend to hate Diego Rivera. I mean, I am not defending him, but as Frida's father warned Diego Rivera before getting married, my daughter is a sick person. If you are going to, marry a sick person, if you are fine with that, you can marry her. Okay. So Frida was a person, as you saw and as you know, with many physical problems, and later on those problems became emotional and mental problems. Frida, one interesting fact is that Frida was the first woman in Mexico to go to psychoanalysis. I mean, even today, Mexicans, they don't believe a lot in going to therapy, mental therapy, okay? And Frida, she knew that something was going wrong with her. So she tried. I believe that she tried the best to cope with those mental problems that she had, and that, unfortunately, Diego didn't help a lot. Just the opposite. Uh-huh.
I feel like throughout this presentation, I've learned so much.
Thank you.
Let me see. Teresa Heath. Thank you for the beautiful insight to the narrative of Frida's painting. Yes. And then for people, when I saw El Venadito, I thought of the song that was a couple of years ago. El Venado, when he talks about, they call him El Venado.
Uh-huh.
There's a, I think it's like bachata type or merengue.
So about the cuernos.
Yes.
Yeah.
The cheating part.
Yes, the cheating part. Uh-huh.
Let's see. Oh, here we go. Do any of the museums in LA have Frida paintings?
Honestly, I don't know. Yeah. I know that there is a museum, well, in Mexico City. There is a Dolores Olmedo Museum in Tlalpan. I believe most of her paintings, and of course, La Casa Azul. And as far as I know, I don't want to say this for sure, but as far as I know, we have exhibits, but they are just temporary exhibits, like in San Francisco, New York. We have had before in Los Angeles, so in LACMA. So if there are any exhibits, they are temporary. But as far as I know right now, we don't have any exhibit on the work of Frida Kahlo.
And I think this one also relates for Mariposa Azul, is the bulk of her art in Mexico or abroad?
Is the bulk of her art? What do you mean, like most of her art?
Mm-hmm. Is her work most in Mexico or is it abroad? I think in Mexico, right? Casa Azul?
Yeah, the bulk, but I'm referring to her actual work in Mexico. Yeah, her work is, again, in two main museums, El Museo Dolores Olmedo, and then La Casa Azul. And this is an interesting detail. Madonna has two of her works. In fact, Madonna, in much is thanks to Madonna that Frida popularized in the United States, when Madonna acquired one of Frida Kahlo's paintings. I think it's My Birth that Madonna bought.
Wow. So we have one more.
Thank you.
Gracias. Nathan Marjorie. Muy interesante. Muchas gracias. So I think those were the only questions left. That was it. And we are on time. So thank you so much. This was so, there's so much knowledge.
There's so much.
And, you know, what a great way to celebrate Frida Kahlo's birthday. So thank you. And thank you to the audience. And hopefully we'll see you live, Dr. Arjona, because you're singing. It's beautiful. And I'm looking forward to seeing you live in one of our events.
It will be my pleasure, Anna.
Before we go, there's a last question about when they can see. So the video will stay live for 24 hours. The recording will stay on YouTube and Facebook for 24 hours. So it can be viewed from now until tomorrow around this time. So if you miss part of it, you can go back and watch again. So thank you so much, everyone. Have a good night and see you next time.
See you. My pleasure.